happened today. I did tell Jason it was really, really lovely, and it's true the past 3 days. And today, he actually flew in on the red eye, which is quite an accomplishment. So we're very grateful to Jason Corburn for joining us. So I met Jason many years ago now, when Jason was a little baby, and I was a teenager.
That's right.
So we actually met when he was a Robert Wood Johnson Health Society Scholar at Columbia,
right?
And he was kind enough to get involved a little bit in a study we were just launching, which was the Mesa Neighborhood Study at that point. And he's gone on to have a very successful career. He is he's a professor at UC Berkeley, and he's a professor in the Department of City and Regional Planning and at the School of Public Health. So he really bridges both areas, and I think he's really been one of the pioneers, and I think leading voices in really bridging these two areas in a way that's really integrative. At Berkeley, he directs the Institute for Urban and Regional Development, and he also directs the Joint Masters of City Planning and a Masters of Public Health program that they have there. And he leads the Center for Global Healthy Cities, so a lot of important initiatives, I think, that are very much aligned with some of the things that we're building here as well. I'm sure you'll get this from his talk, but he really brings together the idea of social justice and equity in cities, and also how to really integrate different kinds of knowledge. So science, local knowledge, and this idea of co-production and how we can learn about health in cities and policy impacts by bringing together different types of knowledge and different types of evidence. So you joined us, and we look forward to hearing.
Thanks, Anna. Well, thanks. It's good to be here, and I'm really a student and product of your dean here, and her work has been incredibly influential in my own thinking and career, and so it's always a pleasure to hang out with you. And we're just saying, I always see her in some other country. It's good to finally be in your neighborhood. I have all these things. You can find out more about me and my work, and I'm going to go through, I know we don't have a lot of time, so I'll go through this talk quite quickly, but really open to questions or about anything I talk about, or about what we're doing at Berkeley, or what we're doing in Kenya, or in Latin America, or whatever I talk about. I'm very interested in how we move from just analyzing the world to how we begin to change it, and how we do that in an informed way, but how we do that in partnership with other experts. Those can be community residents, and those are often, in my view, if we're going to actually be effective in urban health, which we need to be because we are on a planet of cities, we need to get out of the discipline of public health in our research and our practice. And I know many of you are thinking about that. So these are some of the things that are guiding some of the work I'll present now. Have kind of, bother me for some time. And some of that is reflected in this recent book that I co-authored with a colleague of mine, Lee Riley, who's an infectious disease doctor at Berkeley. And so I'm going to go through this quickly because I know you all are have drank the Kool-Aid of urban health as and cities and health, right? I'm in the right place. Usually I have to convince people cities matter, convince people that there's that we're paying attention in terms of the kind of leading scientific journals. And there's been a lot of work recently, like Habitat 3, which was the kind of what I told my kids, the urban planning Olympics, was just in Quito a few months ago, which was really to set, it happens every 20 years, so it was really to set the global, what they called the new urban agenda. Just last year also was this second global report on urban health. But none of these, in fact, the Habitat 3 conference didn't have any section on health. This was the new urban agenda. There was no section on health. We had transportation, we had poverty, we had inclusive cities, we had governance, we had climate change, nothing on health. Maybe, well, you say, well, health should have been integrated into all of those. It really wasn't. safety was the closest thing they had to help. At the very last minute, some folks that Anna and I have been working with at WHO kind of tried to integrate a white paper on health. But it's still really, I think, disconnected both from the folks who are living with inequalities in cities. Much of this work is ahistorical. It doesn't understand how we got to the challenges we have today. And very rarely do we engage in the kind of messy politics, the institutions that actually shape urban environments. We're much more comfortable just using population or place-based data and analyzing that, not trying to understand what are the institutions that need to change their behavior and their decision-making to change those outcomes that we're measuring. I'm going to talk, again, very quickly about three places where I'm doing a lot of work right now. There, I know I could say a lot more than I'm going to say about them. But I think there's this theme that I want to emphasize about how do we turn a city from managing for efficiency, for example, to promoting life and promoting equity in particular. And I'm going to talk first about the city of Richmond, California, which is located here in the Bay Area, which for many years was one of the most violent cities in the United States. In fact, it was the ninth most violent city in the United States, ranked in the top 30 in the world in gun violence up and through 2009. And it was also, it's one of the most polluted. It has a major petrochemical refinery, Chevron, now owned by Chevron, that's been there about 100 years, actually. And it had, by every measure, and I could go spend the rest of the talk talking about all chronic disease differences spatially in the Bay Area, and Richmond, East Oakland would pop up with the worst health outcomes. But the question we asked, starting in about 2007 and 8, was how can we do something different? How can we turn this around? So just a little bit of context. Richmond developed purposefully as what was called at the time the Pittsburgh of the West. Heavy industry. It was really the industrial hub for the San Francisco Bay Area. This refinery is still in place by Chevron. People living literally right across the street. This is Perez Elementary School, which is just on the other side of the fence line from this. And it's really, I think importantly for us, one of the challenges is it's very much a refinery, it's a company town. Chevron for decades controlled all decision making. In fact, they didn't pay any tax, but they controlled the mayor and the city council. It's also a really interesting place. I think it's interesting because this is the home of the Kaiser shipyards where they built the war machine for World War II and then funded the Kaiser Health Plan. That emerged out of that came from Richmond. Kaiser still has a major hospital in Richmond. And part of the shipyards was interesting because it started organizing particularly women and people of color to demand rights, occupational safety, housing. This is one of the most important occupational civil rights cases called James versus Marin Ship, which was in Richmond, that Thurgood Marshall argued as a lawyer in California before he went to the Supreme Court. So the civil rights movement had anchors in the labor movement in Richmond. Also, Richmond was one of the places with the largest amount of public housing in the United States in the 1950s, second only to New York City, which was incredible. It was mostly built by industry. Ford and Kaiser were building housing. Dorothy Lange did a whole photo essay. This is one of her photos on the Richmond public housing. And the worker housing. And in fact, much of this housing is still there today, mold infested, lots of problems. So there's this rich history also of community organizing. The Black Panther movement that came out of Oakland actually came out of Richmond and Oakland. The food pantry program that the Black Panthers are so well known for started, in fact, in Richmond. So there was a lot of organizing. Richmond, the Kaiser shipyards brought African Americans from the Southeast, from Louisiana and Tennessee, to work in labor and a large African American population. And the environmental justice movement, on the West Coast at least, got its start in Richmond, an organization in the 1980s called the West County Toxics Coalition. So all this was really important to understand what we're facing today in terms of opportunities, organizing, organizations, knowledge, etc. So again, these are the maps we created, tons of these, like you've seen these around the world. This is Richmond, West Oakland, and East Oakland with the lowest life expectancy in the Bay Area. And this is by zip code, and again, we could go through every chronic disease, and we basically see the similar pattern. One of the other things we did also, because of issues of crime and violence that I mentioned, was to look at where are parolees located. This is Contra Costa County, the county that Richmond sits in. Richmond's over here, right here, and the highest concentration. So there was an issue of extracting people from neighborhoods in terms of incarceration and people returning, and all the challenges, particularly that felons face in terms of housing and social services, heavily burdening Richmond. So we started at the demand of some of these community organizations to say, the work in Richmond is not supporting health. It's not supporting our needs in terms of violence, environmental justice issues, affordable housing, economic opportunities. So we launched a process that was actually part of what's called the general plan, which is the city's kind of constitution for its future development. And instead of asking, what's wrong here? How can we measure what's wrong? We asked, what makes your community healthy? And there's a series of big and small community meetings and processes that resulted in actually community-gathered data, kind of CBPR reports by a bunch of coalitions. These are just two examples. One's called the Richmond Equitable Development Initiative, and another, Measuring What Matters, which were, again, community getting together to measure what they think are both assets and hazards in their own place. And that really acted as the foundation for both political mobilization and eventually this general plan that I'm going to talk about in a second. The political mobilization was important because in 2008, Richmond became the largest city in the United States to elect a Green Party mayor. And it was the first time that this coalition of community organizations had mobilized. You think the Bay Area is so progressive, but Richmond was controlled for many, many years, like I said, by Chevron in terms of its politics. This was a major change, because this mayor then said, well, we're going to ask Chevron to actually pay tax. We're going to actually try to respond to these community needs. And this set in motion a whole series of things that are still in place today. The driving framework for what we're doing in Richmond emerged out of that community research. Those reports that I just showed you highlighted that there were multiple hazards and stressors that folks faced. And so we, through community process, kind of borrowed this toxic stress idea, which is not new, but was really a new way of organizing community ideas and set in motion a set of processes where community members defined what were the stressors that they faced and what were potential things to reduce those toxic stressors in their neighborhood. And this was also about a 9-month process that led up to what was called the community health and wellness element, which is basically a chapter in the city's general plan. Now, in California and many states in the cities, counties, and states have to have a plan. Basically, what are you going to do for the next 20 or 30 years in terms of development, housing, transportation, economic opportunities, etc.? There's 7 required elements or chapters in California. Health is not one of them. This was the first time in any jurisdiction in the state of California that a community health and wellness element had been built into to a general plan. Now, it was important because it kind of became a legal mandate, a set of policies, a set of indicators, a set of action items that now the city had to be held accountable for. Most plans, and like most of our research, sits on a shelf and nobody reads it. So we decided that could we get some money to do an implementation strategy? So we went to the California Endowment. We managed to get a little over $100,000 or about $150,000 to launch a year and a half implementation strategy, actually before the plan was officially adopted. And our strategy was to not take on the whole city, even though Richmond's fairly small, about 120,000, small little city, even though it has a bunch of challenges. We were going to, what we called kind of target, focus in on certain populations, certain neighborhoods that were experiencing the most inequalities. And we called this target universalism. You may have heard this, and the concept is kind of like the American Disabilities Act, which required curb cuts. Right, I'm a planner, so we think about things like this, which made it much more fair and equitable for people with mobility challenges to, say, for example, cross the street. But the implication was that that curb cut actually had benefits for all of us, for elderly crossing the street, for people with strollers, bicycling, deliveries. So there's this kind of universal benefit by targeting in to particular places and populations. We also borrowed, obviously, from the harm reduction literature and frameworks to do this. So we targeted this one neighborhood called the Iron Triangle. And it's called the Iron Triangle because it's surrounded on three sides by railroad, well, two sides now by railroad tracks. The third used to be the terminus of the Transcontinental Railroad, which was a earth berm that was 8 feet high, which literally walled in the entire neighborhood. It's about 30,000 people, 99% folks of color, African-American and Latino and Laotian. And we started with things that were actually no cost to the residents or the city. So this, you know, kind of transforming cities seems to be really expensive, but there are lots of little things you can do with no cost. So the city repaints and paves its street already within its budget. So the community said, well, why don't we change the parking? Let's do road diets to slow down traffic, because there were lots of injuries and kids playing in the street because there were no quality green and park spaces. But then they said, well, why don't we reprogram these park spaces? So the city said, well, there's all these liability issues. Community groups, two groups were formed to actually take over. The city basically granted them the property to reprogram them and design them themselves. Again, with just this $150,000 from the California Endowment Grant to launch these processes, lots of sweat equity, lots of community design, and reprogram things like tennis courts, which were no one was using, into futsal, soccer fields, and things like that, and basically took abandoned lots and turned them back into community spaces. So the idea was, could we kind of what we call build the kind of increase the heartbeat of this community? This was Elm Play Lot, almost in the center of the community, and could we see this reverberation out of health and equity and inclusion? This was another park here. This is Pogo Park, and begin to have a broader community impact. Well, it didn't have that impact. We fell very short. And I think one of the reasons we fell short was because we didn't include enough of these partners. So we launched a new initiative based on the learning from this effort called the Richmond Health Equity Partnership, which is still in place today, which had a much broader set of partners. Richmond doesn't have a health department, so all of this work was done by the city. The health department was kind of in and out. The city also doesn't control its school district. That's a different entity, a much larger jurisdiction. We didn't engage the school district initially. So we brought in new partners, and we developed a set of specific strategies. I'm just going to talk about very briefly this health in all policies idea that we borrowed again from a work happening in California and internationally to say, can we get more specific about what are the decisions, the policies, the indicators to promote health equity in Richmond? So we launched a process that drafted and eventually became the first health and all policies ordinance, municipal ordinance in the United States. And it had things like requirements of structural racism and health equity training for every city employee, which still goes on today. We have health equity indicators that came originally from that community research I talked about, built into the city's five-year budget plan, and that's going on today. And some of these other things around housing, reintegrating health services into schools, again, that was important. We've got the clinic, a lot of youth organizing, a lot of the violence kind of creating a lot of trauma and trauma recovery, prisoner reentry I talked about, and in part because of the mayor's support of a major lawsuit to sue Chevron to pay its utility tax and to reduce its pollution. It was trying to process crude oil from Canada and would have been much heavier emissions from the facility. And some of these things are still going on and emerging today. Just going to talk about a couple of things. One is jobs. Economic opportunity is a critical health determinant, as we know. We helped launch something called Richmond Build, which is a job training program for kids in public housing and formerly incarcerated folks with a very small US EPA grant. I don't know if the EPA will still be in existence anymore, but it was a very important program which taught basic construction skills, but also we worked to install with the utility a solar power on many homes. Of course, we have some sun in California. And we were able to do that on many, many people's homes who were all, sometimes Section 8 and in affordable housing. And what we found is at least $900 per year in savings per household from having solar. Some places are able to actually sell back energy to the utility. That's a significant savings for families, for very low-income families. Last example from Richmond is our violence prevention work. And I think you may have seen this. This stuff has been gotten a lot of press nationally and internationally. Michelle Obama came to visit CNN, Nightline. So we're talking about something called the Office of Neighborhood Safety. So we made a decision early on to take violence prevention outside of law enforcement. We looked at ceasefire and all these great programs and said, it's not going to work in Richmond. Nobody trusts the police. Nobody trusts the government, in fact. And so the idea was, how do we reorient the face of the government, the face of the city, the face of the state to the community? So we created a new city agency called the Office of Neighborhood Safety, right in there with the Parks Department and planning and housing. And the idea was to combine what we knew of kind of individual street-level outreach with place-based targeted intervention. So targeting the 25 to 30 known trigger pullers. There were three gangs in Richmond, all fighting over a few blocks. Again, very high gun homicides. And every law enforcement agency, from the FBI to ATF to the local police department, knew, in fact, who these people were. They're mostly young guys, mostly young men. So we said, if we reach out to them and engage them, can we change the landscape of violence in the city? At the same time, doing this place-based intervention. Now, it was very controversial for a number of reasons, which I'll get into. A $3 million annual budget. But when we started, 1 month of police overtime in Richmond was costing between $400,000 and $600,000. Most of that overtime was because of gunshots and responding to them. And just the EMT costs and the hospitalization costs were estimated about $200,000 to $300,000 per shooting. So a $3 million annual budget to reduce some of this didn't seem so radical. It's two major strategies of the ONS, the Office of Neighborhood Safety. One is the street-level outreach. So we hired felons, guys right out of San Quentin doing done serious time for murder, to become city employees. Now, as any of you know, if you have a record and you're a felon, you can't get hired by government. This was a major challenge for us to convince the city to hire these guys. And that took about 2 years. But we stuck with it, and now we have these change agents. And they do street-level outreach, engage young people who are in conflicts or likely trigger pullers, as they're called by the change agents. They mediate conflicts, and they provide this kind of peacemaking at the street level. The other part of this was a fellowship program where we said, we want to bring these young people into City Hall, into city government, as experts to develop the change strategies that they need. The service agencies said, you know, hey, we've got drug rehabilitation programs. So we said, okay, can you take this young guy into your program? Sure. So he walks in the first day, and the drug counselor says, hey, are you high? He says, of course I'm high. I just smoked up before I came in. Okay, leave. Come back when you're not high. Or an anger management program. Lots of anger management programs. These guys would go in there and they say, okay, are you angry? He said, yeah, I'm really angry. Okay, come back when you're not angry. And it was like these programs were in place, but they really weren't serving this population. So this fellowship was really a way to kind of develop a set of strategies to get folks into services, get them a life strategy, mentoring, travel. And the most controversial part, the part that CNN focuses on, is that we pay these guys a fellowship, a small stipend to participate. And we stole that idea, or borrowed that idea, from Latin American programs of conditional cash transfers, which had proven to be somewhat successful in encouraging people to participate in quote-unquote healthy behaviors. Now, they can make up to $1,000 a month by participating in this program. Only a few guys have ever done that. And here's what's happened since we launched it. Officially, our first class of fellows was in 2010. So we've had about 25 of these young guys come through. A couple fall out during the 18-month process. The average cost per year is about $61,000, $2,500 per fellow. But most importantly, 94% are still alive. 84% are not engaged in gun violence. We see the community-wide impacts. And we went from, in 2009, 42 homicides per 100,000, again, top 10 in the United States, to 11. And this is just to put that into perspective of some of the most violent cities in the world, which is Caracas and in the U.S. So we feel like this is a important part of rebuilding a city for life. If you don't reduce violence, all the other built environment and social programs are at risk. Because people are in fear or they're not engaging in their community. These are some of the other things. We launched, actually, when we first started, a biannual community survey that's funded by the city to kind of about 120-something questions, self-rated health, a bunch of things about how people perceive their place, their neighborhood, government services. So we're able to track some of these things in terms of impact. And we're doing more of that studying now. And again, we started with about 200,000, and we've leveraged that into about 22 million in external grants from the city, from the state, from private foundations, and to some extent the federal government. I'm going to give two more examples. I don't know if I can get through it all. I know you have a team here with a really important grant in Latin America, and that I've been doing some work in a couple of countries right now, focused largely in Colombia and Medellin. We actually have a former mayor of Medellin at Cal at Berkeley for the year, and he's been bringing some of his colleagues from civil society, from community organizations, from government to join our seminar to say, well, how did this happen? Hopefully some of you know, or you may know, that Medellin was the most violent city in the world. Now it's not even in the top 100 in 15, 20 years. Not only that, but it's radically transformed its built environment, its social conditions, poverty status, in a relatively short period of time. It's the shining example of urban health for some of us, or in some ways, in the world. And it just won the most prestigious, supposedly, award of cities in the world. And it had never gone to a city outside of North America or Europe, first time to a city in Latin America or, again, outside of Europe. So this is the trend of what's happened in Medellin. And in the last, 20 to 30 years, this incredible decline in homicides. Now, there's a lot been happening nationally and locally, in terms of drug trafficking, in terms of the Civil War. But there was a lot actually that changed constitutionally and locally that I think helped enable this to happen. So all the mayors for cities in Colombia were appointed up until 1990, 91 constitutional change. They had their first elected mayor. So you begin to see an emergence, a new democracy, like we see in other parts of Latin America around this time. Then a strategic plan that is a long-range plan. Again, I'm a planner in part. Sometimes I take on that role. And that it was important that every new administration had to reference this plan. So there was a plan, a long-range strategic plan, and then a plan that was also supported by the central government around housing and recreation as violence reduction. So not just around policing as violence reduction, and that was significant, and that happened in 2001 and 2002. So the idea that plans matter, I think, a theme in Richmond and in Colombia. So of course, some of these examples, hopefully you know, but if you don't, this is, I guess, hard to see. We'll blame it on the PC. But going from very isolated barrios, communities on steep slopes, disconnected from the rest of the city, to what everyone sees as a huge innovation, but this was no innovation. This was just the first time that a cable car that I guess you use in weather like this for skiing to get up a mountain was used for public transportation. now this is all over the place. Well, not all over the place, but in Latin America it's spreading, particularly in places like Rio. So the Metrocable integrated communities that had been disconnected from the city and began to help revitalize neighborhoods. Then they said, well, how do we get upstairs in a shopping mall or an airport, an electric escalator? Could we do the same thing, use the same technology? No innovation in technology. We don't need a new app. We already have the technology. But can we connect people so that they can bring their groceries up and not have to pay off the gang, motorcycle gang that potentially drove them up the hill or whatever it was, radically? And I should mention that in Medellin, that the strategy was go to the worst, most violent neighborhoods first and invest with the most public resources. So the Metrocable, the escalators in Comuna 13, where this was the most violent neighborhood in Medellin. They built libraries and big public spaces, again, in the most impoverished neighborhoods, new schools, new hospitals. Their biggest cancer hospital is in the poorest neighborhood. So it's just a kind of flipping the thinking in municipal development that when you want to build something new and beautiful, and they built it beautifully, which they had all of these competitions for the most beautiful designs for, this is a library that's well known. You do it in the neighborhoods that are the most deprived, not in your downtown, in your museum district, in your arts district. Get rid of that. And I think that's a radical idea. Then they said, well, we've got all of this public space that the utility owns. This was water storage tanks. They had, and basically around the world, you've got lots of public space that's walled off or fenced off and not accessible to communities that don't have any public space, green space, places to play. So they said, well, can we tear down those walls and open them up? And that's what they did with hundreds of facilities that were owned by the municipal utility, EPM, which was their water, sewer, and basically monopoly, to create these public spaces. They're places of art, for play, for all a host of things. They took the city's largest garbage dump and turned it into an urban ecological center and farm. So it was both kind of flipping the idea of this is a neighborhood that gets dumped onto a neighborhood that's worth investing in and growing life. And it's got these kind of tiered farming, and it's mostly for education, not so much for food production. But it's actually an incredibly beautiful place that used to be incredibly smelly on garbage dump. And like Richmond, we see this incredible decline, actually more incredible here in terms of poverty, which showed the violence, employment, and the long-range impacts. There's a lot more to Medellin, but the idea is that we can invest in a different way in cities that prioritize communities that are most suffering and most in need. Final example, take you to another part of the world in Nairobi, where we also have a long-standing collaboration with a whole host of universities and community organizations and local government to try to transform the informal settlements from, again, places of disease and deprivation to places of life. Slum health, informal settlement health is somewhat getting better. Here's some data from Bangladesh and Nairobi. This is under 5 childhood mortality. But still living in a city can be healthier in the global south, but it matters where you live. So if you're living in an informal settlement or a slum, you still haven't seen the same gains of those living in cities or even in those living in more rural areas, including those living in poverty in rural areas. So we're not doing as well improving urban health as we actually are improving rural health around the world. And that's a big challenge, and I know one that Anna's going to solve for us. But in Nairobi, this is where we are. Here's the two major communities we're working in, Mathare and Makuru, right now. You may have heard of Kibera, which is down here, sometimes referred to as the largest slum or informal settlement in Africa. It's actually not, but it's pretty big. And it's a really complex place, like any neighborhood. you know, you go to South Philly or North Philly or Richmond, it's not everybody has the same stressors, everyone has the same living conditions, everyone has not everybody's at the same poverty rate. So all of our population health assumptions need to be thrown out in some ways, and we need to get inside and understand context, even within the same informal settlement. So, you know, these things have 13, 20 different villages or neighborhoods, all with really different dynamics. Just as one example, this is electricity, which is not provided by the state. It's provided by youth cartels, which provide an incredibly important service of electricity for lighting, and they charge 30 times or more what a middle-class person with the public utility getting electricity is. But they also provide free lighting for security, like in street lighting. They have created a system that avoids what you have in Lagos, in Nigeria, across Nigeria, which are polluting generators. Everyone's running a generator all the time for electricity. And they employ a lot of people. But their informal connections, or some people call them illegal connections, lead to fires every other day and lots of injuries. So it's not all good and it's not all bad. So we need to understand this in its context. Water, a major issue. This is public water access. Again, this is also controlled often by some kind of cartel or youth gang, because there's a lot of money to be made, people paying for a service, and they're often paying off even the utility that provides terrible service. But there's also a robust economy. In Nairobi, for example, 65% of the city's economy comes from the informal sector. And that's almost, by some estimates, by the Kenyan Bureau of Statistics, around 50% of the country's GDP is generated in the informal sector, not just in Nairobi, but across the country, creating like 500,000 jobs in a year, while the formal sector creates 30,000 maybe. So we can't just wipe out these communities without recognizing the great contribution they're actually making to the entire city and the entire economy in a lot of healthy, productive activities. So one of the way we're going about kind of understanding change and instituting change in Nairobi is working with our partners to actually document who's living in these quote-unquote illegal communities, informal settlements, and then using that to advocate for and to institute some physical and policy change. So it starts with something called micro savings. And what that is small amounts of money people save every day in an organization. It's like, you may have heard of microcredit, but it's a bit different, where it's not explicitly about lending and paying back. It's really about building an organization and people being invested through the micro savings. And eventually the savings does help finance things like improvements for housing or emergency health care or child care or different things that people need. But the organization then comes together and actually surveys. We do a door-to-door enumeration, every household in the community, and physically map the place, all of the assets and hazards. So how wide the pathways are, where are all the dump sites, where are people burning garbage, etc. And build that into a process of mobilization and change. We've gotten a lot of attention for some of this work. These are our partners. We partner with a lot of university students that are young people, and they connect with our community organization and nonprofit partners. So this is a map of Makuru that we recently finished, and this doesn't make any sense to you. It's just to show that there's about 80,000 structures, about 60,000 households, and we have detailed data on every one of these structures in GIS that our community partners help generate. So we can click on this structure here, and I can tell you who lives there, how much they pay for water, how far they have to travel for health care, what clinic they might go to, a whole host of things, incredibly rich data. But we use that to then plan for an upgrading and change. This is one example of housing, where we do kind of these dream designs, and then it's built in the home while people live there. So they live in the structure, and it's built incrementally as they live in it. And this is what some of it looks like when it's done. Water and sanitation are huge issues. This is Mathare, where we've mapped the public water points And then put that in perspective of the sphere humanitarian standards. So when there's a tsunami or an earthquake or some crisis, this is what the UN recommends as the maximum number of people per water point in an emergency temporary crisis situation, 250. This is what we have on an everyday basis in these communities. These are 13 different villages or neighborhoods. When we took that information and generated a kind of participatory design process to develop the first metered water service to the informal settlements in Nairobi. So that people are already paying, like I said, 30 times sometimes the rate of water that middle class and upper class people are getting in outside of the slums. So the water utility was very interested in working with us and actually financing this because they could capture some of that cost. People were already paying. And so this is what it now looks like, over 20,000 households with an in-home water tap. And some of the evaluation that's still ongoing shows some of these health benefits, particularly the household income impacts have been quite significant. And the missed school days and burden on women, so there's a very strong gender dimension to basic services in this place. Food, from our data, suggests that this was the biggest expense. In fact, it's probably for you your biggest expense too. And there was a lot of related health impacts of food insecurity and high food costs. So people were skipping meals. They were skipping meals to feed their kids. Women, young women, were selling sex to feed themselves or their children. And of course, there's lots of great NGOs, particularly from the U.S., giving out ARVs and there's two TB clinics, but people weren't able to comply, or they were selling off their drugs because they didn't have food to take with their medication. So we've done things like build a cooperative food vendors association to increase food security. There's a lot of street food vending. There's a lot of hygiene issues. There's a lot of bulk purchasing and credit purchasing issues that have helped stabilize some of this industry. Finally, toilets, particularly for women and girls, a huge health issue and a human rights issue that we've been working on for quite some time. This is a toilet, typical toilet in the community. Sometimes it has a lock, sometimes not. Rarely has lights at night. It's a very big priority, too, for the Sustainable Development Goals, which were just recently announced, like the MDGs. To stop things like open defecation, which is also quite rampant in these communities. So we've done the same thing around toilets, that we did with water, so showing the spatial distribution. Again, very powerful even for people who live here to document the access to services they have. Again, the sphere humanitarian standard is 20 people per toilet. This is again what we have in these villages, these communities, on an everyday basis. Part of our campaign was to capture the experiences of young women, of girls, and our partners ran a school essay competition. It was really just a program for people to actually write about their experience of not having a safe or clean toilet on a regular basis and the kinds of things they experience. And we were able to work with organizations like Amnesty International to publish this and get a lot of international attention to pressure the government and private agencies, and people like the Gates Foundation, which were continuing funding pit latrine toilets, which were seen as completely inadequate by these folks, and really make this a issue of sexual violence and human rights, particularly for women. We took our data and filed the first civil action lawsuit on behalf of 20,000 slum dweller women to pressure the Kenyan government and the health ministry to deliver this right. In fact, the Kenyan constitution says, hey, a health and a clean toilet, a safe toilet, is a human right in our constitution. And they weren't able to deliver that. So this is actually an ongoing process now. And importantly, we kind of have taken some of this place-based work and data and look to make prevention policy This is the Kenyan National Slum Upgrading and Prevention Policy, which was passed in 2014, which a lot of our partners worked on and used much of our data to make the case about what that policy ought to look like, how it ought to be implemented, and the kinds of things that we need to monitor to ensure that we are actually upgrading and preventing new informal settlements. Here's a few outcomes. I mean, it's not all good. We've got some new services and built environment changes, reductions in some infectious disease, a little increase, this is from when we started roughly in 2009 to 2015, of self-rated health for women in Makuru and Mathare, but an increase in fear of sexual violence and some work we're doing in partnership with an organization called African Population and Health Research Center on hypertension of slum dweller women in particular seems to be on the rise and a significant risk factor that was basically ignored because people were just focused on things like diarrhea and infection, HIV, but chronic illnesses and the implications particularly for women are increasingly significant. So just to wrap up, thinking about what does it mean to do urban health that is radically inclusive? What does that look like? So moving from this idea of thinking about a single disease or a single risk factor to thinking about these multidimensional aspects of people and places and the institutions that shape them. How do we think spatially about redefining the face of the state? I'm a big fan of big government. I know that's not very popular. But if we're going to make progress, I think, in urban health, we need to rethink the role of government, big or small, Philadelphia to Columbia. And right now, in many places, particularly in many communities facing the greatest health inequalities, the only face of the state, of the government, is police and violence. How do we turn that around to make it about engagement, equity, and health? How do we move from just our sort of small-scale boutique projects that we're really good at, particularly in planning, we do one-off things and pat ourselves on the back for building a toilet or, you know, greening a park or making a bike lane, to really institutionalizing this in the way cities do business on an everyday basis. And that's going to really require a new way of thinking of you all. I know you're getting new kinds of training and a new urban health science that's really about this interdisciplinary idea of drawing from the best of social epidemiology, of planning, of social sciences, of history, of many, many disciplines, and understanding the complex biology that happens in people's bodies as they are facing these multiple stressors, and really using that to develop indicators to monitor and track how we go, and to not wait till we have all the answers to act, because it's just too urgent of a situation to do that. So I'll stop there and take any questions.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm curious where gentrification comes in. I mean, I don't know in Richmond, some of these improvements, has it created development and gentrification around these neighborhoods, or is that even an issue in the Dean? But where do you think gentrification fits into some of these community improvements?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. Gentrification, displacement, it does happen. So in Richmond, it's not quite happening the same way it's been happening in San Francisco or Oakland. Part of that is it's just not as cool and trendy a place just yet. But also the other part is that much of the change has been controlled and a pace of change by a partnership between community organizations and government. I think when we see the development of housing and of new parks and new assets in communities, the rapid change and the lack of community control over what that looks like and how that happens, often driven by well-meaning government or private sector, enhances, I think, and kind of puts on steroids the displacement and gentrification that happens. So we have things like some of the community groups, particularly around those parks that I showed, have developed land trusts where they've used some of their grant money to actually purchase housing. We have a program on social impact bonds in Richmond that where the Richmond Community Foundation, which is one of the partners, buys, issues these social impact bonds, and get investment to buy homes and then rehabilitate them, and that the homeowners or turns it back into affordable housing so local people can stay in the neighborhood. It's not perfect. It's happening. Medellin has a different program where they have a much stronger role of the state, where they require all new development to have a certain percentage. They make them smaller units, but they're affordable, of different levels of income, to ensure that there isn't a lot of displacement. There's been some, but I mean, so far, I think our research and the folks we've talked to, there is not widespread displacement in some of the neighborhoods that have been deeply invested in. It is happening in Nairobi. There's a couple of competing programs where the government built new housing, 5-6-story formal housing in Kibera and in Mathare, and they actually micro loans gave it to slum dwellers. And what did they do? They got the house, they said thank you, and then they leased it off to somebody else and went back to living in their shack, because it was just, it's prime real estate. So it's a difficult dynamic. It's one that I think we need to be attentive to. It's for me, the struggle is I can't go into work with the community organizations and folks who are facing violence and lack of services and say, no, let's not do anything because we're afraid that you might not benefit 5-10 years from this improvement. That's just not how it works in communities who really need our resources, I don't think.
How is the work in Medellin funded? Was it mostly state financing?
Yeah, great question. It's very unique. They have two major sources of funding. One is that they have very high taxes, and people pay tax, and a pretty robust tax system. The other unique thing that Medellin has that like Bogota does not have in Colombia is a public utility called IPM. And they are a monopoly, and they've been around for a long time, and they do the water, the sewer, even IT, telecom, electricity. And they, by law, are required to, I think, put, I can't remember the exact percentage, but it's a significant, somewhere between 30-50% of their profits into the city's budget for community-based investments. And that's been a major source of funding for some of the transformation there. So people say, hey, Medellin's unique, not like any other place in the world. I worked for New York City government earlier in my career. Every meeting I went to, everyone said, New York City, that's so unique. It's not like any other place. I moved to San Francisco. I worked for San Francisco Public Health Department. We did health impact assessment. Everyone said, don't write about that. San Francisco is too unique. Yeah. So wherever you go in the world, it's unique. That's why cities are amazing and important to study, because they are unique. And that's important to know. It doesn't mean it's not relevant or interesting. So there is a somewhat unique, but not unprecedented. I mean, city of Lagos, one of the most formerly dysfunctional cities in the world, has a very progressive new tax system where they're collecting money to do lots of things, good and bad. But it can be done, even in the places where you think it's not possible. There's a lot written about that, and I can send you more resources on that, the financing of that work.
So you're talking in Kenya about how 50% of the GDP is informal. Can you give some examples of what that would be, and what do they try to formalize it, or do they try to train people to do new stuff that's more part of the mainstream economy?
Yeah, it's a great question. It's a lot of things. It's everything from services to schools. There's tons of informal schools, even though the state provides free education. There's just not enough space, and people don't trust the state schools, so they send their kids to informal schools. It's furniture building. It's housing construction. It's the informal labor. Labor. So it's a whole host of services, small manufacturing, labor. It's big.
Does it just mean they don't pay taxes? What do you mean by informal when you're talking about?
It's all cash. Yeah, all cash, no taxes, not formalized in terms of registered businesses or part of the quote unquote formal economy. Now, why does it remain that way? Because, in my view, it's not just my view, but there's a lot of entrenched, very strong economic interests to keep it that way. So a lot of people make money off of poor folks. They're charging 10, 30, 200 times for the same service that they can get in the informal sector. They brew some crazy alcohol in these communities. But who's, you got these local guys brewing it, but who's behind it is actually the same national brewing company that brews Tusker beer, which is like their national brand. So there's a lot of entrenched, high-powered interests in keeping the informal economy informal and keeping these services informal, because everybody's getting a slice, a piece of that 200% markup, that poverty penalty is going to all of these different institutions. So not understanding that complex landscape, we say, hey, public health, let's just deliver this necessary service. You're going to run into a lot of challenges if you don't understand that complexity. Yeah, I skipped over you. Well, I don't know if I have anything more beyond some of these examples. I've written about these in more depth in other places. But, my three pieces of advice are in terms of building the political will is to, you have to start somewhere in partnership with people and start doing things rather than just analyzing. The second piece is you've got to start somewhere with people, build collaboration and start doing things. And the third thing is you've got to start somewhere, build collaborations and do it. There's no magic formula. I'm a big fan of kind of learning by doing, trial and error, building collaborations that build towards political change. I don't think there's a magic solution to say, okay, everyone's going to be enlightened. But I just spent 4 or 5 months, a little more, at WHO in Geneva. The whole organization is about the biomedical model. So to say, to say people are on board with this in public health, maybe in this place, but you go to other public health, big powerful institutions, they're still giving advice that is not consistent with deep engagement with place, understanding collaborative data collection, thinking about urban institutions. They're still dealing with, high-level state agencies, mostly the medical, which means the health service providers, the doctors, not the public health infrastructure, and not the non-public health infrastructure like transportation, community development, and the rest of that. I mean, the division that our friend Carlos directs has like 12 people in Geneva and a few people scattered around the world. Maybe Papo has the most infrastructure around this work, and I think it's doing great stuff. But so the WHO is not really on board with this, I think, maybe others would disagree. But so I think we got work to do to show kind of proof of concept that we got to do it. Yeah, in the back.
Thanks, and thanks for the presentation. So just to say to you that as someone who co-chaired the mayor's transition on health and human services over a year ago, your work, we handed over a lot of this. I had the opportunity to speak to Sasha Girl.
Oh, good.
These are city administrators in Richmond. So the specific question, she almost sounded like she could just be faculty at a public health, urban health collaborative overnight. Talk to the ownership and relationship. I hear what you just said, and I appreciate it. We're a relatively big city. It's still been hard to have them form what we recommended, which is sort of a steering committee that reports and works with the mayor and spans these big projects. Instead, we continue to have smatterings of projects, different departments that will allow us in some of the mapping. But there isn't really a steering overhead kind of deal for the city. And yet, your folks, it's smaller, but Richmond, there was such ownership when we spoke to them and interviewed them about what was important for sustainability and to own this.
Yeah. In 2000, if you would have came up there in 2006 and 7 when we started, people would have said, health? That's not us. That's the county health department. Health? I'm in the city. I don't do that. I don't even know what health is. What do I have to do with health? In fact, we have on record the city manager and the mayor and Shasta's team across the city agencies saying, I have no idea what you're talking about. Health, city health, what do we have to do with health? That's what happens.
About equity and stress, by the way, everyone. So this is fascinating.
So it was a slow process. And it's actually, we tried to do a kind of central coordinating the health equity partnership. And there are a lot of partners, but there's a lot of other initiatives going on that we sometimes align with, and sometimes they're doing their own thing. Some of the youth work, some of the work that the California Endowment is funding on its Building Healthy Communities. So it's not that there can only be one show in town to, I think, get this work done. There can be a central table, and maybe there ought to be, and this I think the city has to be a co-leader with that. But it should also help facilitate, you know, other initiatives that can do things maybe with more flexibility and maybe not as tied down sometimes as government can be. But it's a long process. But I'm getting older. I'm realizing 10 years is not so long. Or 12 years or 15 years even in Medellin. So that's not a bad time horizon to make some significant population change. But it took 4 or 5 years to get city on board. We did a lot of training, a lot of engagement with every city agency, from the police chief all the way down. And they slowly kind of got on board. But it wasn't like, okay, you know, we showed them the data and they said, oh yeah, come on, let's do it.
Unfortunately, I think we're going to have to wrap up, but there'll be more opportunities to talk to Jason in the afternoon. So I just want to thank him again for a terrific presentation.
Thank you.